this video, we'll see the addressing modes present in PIC16F877 microcontroller. So the addressing mode is the way by which the operands are accessed. So there are three addressing modes available in PIC16F877. That is, first one is direct addressing mode. So in this mode, the direct address is given in the instruction itself. That direct address can be address of a RAM memory location, or it can be any SFR. So for the direct addressing, the 7-bit address is taken directly from the instruction, and there are four banks in RAM memory, that is bank 0, 1, 2 and 3. So at a time, only one bank will be selected. That bank is selected with the help of RP1 and RP0 bits, which are present in status register. So in this diagram, we can see that we have a 7-bit address that is taken from the instruction, and the two bits, that is RP1 and RP0, these two bits decide the bank. So in every bank, we have 7F locations, that is total 128 bytes. And after this bank 0, the next bank is bank 1, then we have bank 2, and then bank 3. So for selecting any location in this individual bank, we need 7 bits. So that 7-bit address decides a unique location in every bank, and that location will be accessed from which bank, that is decided with the help of these two bits, that is RP1 and RP0. So combining this, we have 7 plus 2, that is 9-bit address, which decides which location will be accessed from the RAM memory location. So these are some of the examples of direct addressing mode. So first we have move WF 34 hex. Now 34 hex is the address location, and this is the direct address of RAM memory. Next instruction is move F 40 hex comma 0. So the meaning of this instruction is that the data available at 40 hex location will be copied to the working register. So here again, 40 hex is the direct address of RAM location. Then last instruction is move WF port D. So here again, port D is going to have a address. So that address is again part of RAM memory. So that's why this, even if it is a SFR or a register, it will be treated as a direct address, and this instruction is of direct addressing mode. Next addressing mode is indirect addressing mode. So in this mode, the pointer is used, which points to the memory location, and using that pointer, the data will be accessed. So in case of PIC16F877, there are two SFRs, namely FSR and INDF. So FSR is the register in which we have to put the address, and this FSR will point to that particular address location. And to access the data from that particular location, we have to use this INDF register. So another thing to note is that INDF is not a physical register. So we have a 8-bit FSR. Okay. In this FSR, we have to put the address that we want to access or we want to point to. So that FSR will act as a memory pointer. So we have to put the 8-bit address in this FSR. So out of that, the 7 bits will be taken, and those 7 bits will be pointing to one location in any of these four banks. And the MSB bit of this FSR along with the IRP bit in status register will decide the bank which will be selected. So the address that is available in these lower 7 bits, that will decide the location, and these two bits will decide the bank. So the examples of indirect addressing mode are move LW 30 hex. So now here we have used this instruction to set a pointer. So with this instruction, 30 hex value, that will be copied to working register. So this instruction is not actually of indirect addressing mode. Just for explanation purpose, we have taken this instruction. Then we have next instruction as move WF FSR. So with this, the value present in will be copied to FSR. So value present in working register is 30 hex. So that will be now copied to FSR. So the memory pointer is now going to point to 30 hex address location in RAM memory. And with this instruction, that is MOVF INDF comma 0, we can access this 30 hex location. So the meaning of this instruction is that move the contents of INDF register to working register, that is comma 0. So INDF is not actually a physical register. So INDF will access the data from the memory location where the FSR register is pointing. So FSR is pointing to 30 hex. So INDF will copy the value available at 30 hex location to working register. So this is how the indirect addressing mode will work. And final addressing mode is immediate addressing mode. Now immediate addressing mode is the mode in which the data is directly given in the instruction. So in case of PIC 16F877, we have 8-bit literal present in the instruction. And this all immediate addressing mode instructions have a letter L in their mnemonic. So whenever any instruction is having a letter L in its mnemonic, then that instruction is of immediate addressing mode. So the example for immediate addressing mode is move LW 55 hex. So with this instruction, the 55 data, that is the 8-bit literal, will be copied to working register. Another example is AND LW. So with this, the data present in working register will be ANDed with this value, 8-bit immediate value, and the result will be stored in working register. So now both these instructions are having L in its mnemonic. So it means that these instructions are of immediate addressing mode, and whatever value is written in these instructions, that is 8-bit literal or 8-bit immediate data. The important register is a status register which has the flags, different flags, which indicate the output of the particular operation. So this is the format for the status register. So it is an 8-bit register with different flags and bits present in it. So starting with LSB, we have a carry flag. So whenever there is a carry generated from the sum, at that time this carry flag will be set to 1. So whenever there is carry from bit number or the MSB bit, at that time this flag will be set. And for borrow also, this flag will be used. In case of borrow, this works in an inverted way. So whenever there is a borrow from MSB, at that time this bit will be 0. Then we have a digit carry flag. So this digit carry flag is set whenever there is a carry from lower nibble to upper nibble. And at the same time, this digit carry flag can also be used as a digit borrow flag. So whenever there is a borrow from lower nibble to upper nibble, at that time also this flag will be used, and in that case this flag will be 0. Next flag is zero flag. This flag will be set whenever the result of any arithmetic or logical operation is 0. Otherwise, if the result is not 0, then this flag will be 0. The next bit is power down bit. So whenever we have executed a sleep instruction, at that time this PD bar bit will become 0, which will indicate that the CPU is in sleep mode or power down mode, and generally it will be 1 otherwise. Next flag is timeout bit. So whenever there is a timeout or whenever the watchdog timer has overflowed, at that time this bit will become 0, or normally it will be 1. Then next two bits are RP1 and RP0. So these two bits are used for selecting the bank. As we know that there are 4 banks in RAM memory, so to select one bank out of 4, we have to use these two bits. So if these two bits are 00, bank 0 will be selected, 01, bank 1 will be selected, 10, bank 2 will be selected, and 11, bank 3 will be selected. And finally we have IRP bit. So this is used for indirect addressing mode, and in this case, whenever this bit is 0, bank 0 and 1 will be selected, and whenever this bit is 1, at that time bank 2 and bank 3 will be selected. So this is the format of status register which has different flags related to different operations. So this is about the addressing modes present in PIC 16F877. In the next video, we'll see the internal peripherals available in PIC16F877 microcontroller. For more information, you can log on to the website given in the description of this video. Thank you.